Good evening, everybody, and thank you all for joining us today from various parts of the country. We hope all of you are safe at home and remain hopeful as we get through this global pandemic and come out stronger and better than before. With that, I would like to thank each of you to the company's Fresh Start Scheme 2020 webinar, brought to you by Vakilsearch, India's leading online legal services provider for SMEs and individuals. My name is Rinoy George, and I will be your host and moderator for this webinar, joining you from my home in Kerala. Our speaker for this webinar will be Vakilsearch's Head of Compliance, Mrs. Ahona Das Gupta, joining us from Chennai. The topic of today's webinar is companies fresh. Yes, hello. Hello, Ahona. So the topic of today's webinar is Companies Fresh Start Scheme 2020. The Ministry of Corporate Affairs introduced the scheme as part of their efforts to give a fresh start to companies as a fully compliant entity and reduce the compliance burden during the unprecedented public health situation caused by COVID-19. The USP of both the schemes is a one-time waiver of additional filing fees for delayed filings by companies or LLPs with the registrar of companies during the currency of schemes. That is during the period starting from 1st April 2020 and ending on 30 September 2020. Today, Ms. Ahona is going to take us through the concept, advantages, applicability, process, and compliance procedure of this through the duration of this webinar. Mm-hmm. Ahona, can you hear me?
Yes, Rinoy. You're audible. Yeah.
Yes. Well, so welcome to this webinar. We look forward to your talk today. So I shall hand this over to you, right? So I think we are ready with the presentation for our viewers.
Great. Thank you, Rinoy. I think you have done half a job of explaining what is this webinar about. Firstly, welcome everyone, and thank you for connecting over this webinar to understand the concept of CFSS Companies Fresh Start Scheme 2020. So as Rinoy already said, that this is a new introduction given by the Ministry of Corporate Affairs for all the companies. Yes, it's a new baby concept that has come in, giving a huge relaxation to a lot of companies who might be stuck in different non-compliant zones. Now, the world as a whole is on a lockdown currently due to this unprecedented situation regarding public health and safety caused by coronavirus pandemic. Amidst this, the Ministry of Corporate Affairs has made an attempt to ease the matter for companies, and they have introduced this scheme known as the Companies Fresh Start Scheme. This was notified through the General Circular number 12 on 30th of March. Let me give a brief idea about how the scheme works. So first question, why did we get this scheme? MCA received various representations from various stakeholders requesting or granting a one-time opportunity to file all pending documents without additional fee. Why we stress upon this aspect of additional fees? Because right from last year, if you have observed any kind of non-compliance, you delay by one day, there is an imposition of 100 rupee penalty per day for companies and for LLPs. This gets quite heavy on pocket when you proceed for doing numerous filings, and default willingly, unwillingly, erroneously, we do end up having making some defaults, and that poses a big heavy hole in our pocket. So this waiver, it's an additional fee waiver which has been given by the Ministry of Corporate Affairs through the company's Fresh Start Settlement scheme. Now, as per the provisions of Companies Act 2013, all companies are required to follow statutory compliances annually. Now, what does this include? This includes annual returns, financial statements, any other form of documents, forms, statements, which are specified in the Companies Act within particular timelines. Non-compliance of the same in filing these with the registrar of companies attracts imposition of penalty and fines. Now, if a company that fails to adhere these compliances, by default, you get tagged as a term called defaulting company. Now, if this default continues over and over again over years, not just the company, but the directors of the company also get tagged along and attract disqualification as per the Section 164 of the Companies Act. The main intention of Government of India, it is to help the companies in India to reduce compliance burden, including financial burden of companies at large, but also to ensure and enable the long-standing non-compliant companies and LLPs to make a fresh start. So it's basically giving you a second chance to come out clean and be compliant. One important point to note over here, this scheme does not absolve a company or its officers in default from any substantial violation of law. You must be wondering, then what is the purpose of the scheme if it doesn't protect you from violating the consequences of violating a section or a provision? Well, that's the reality of the situation. We cannot help in that. But to be very clear on this, the immunity is only with respect to filing of belated documents under the scheme. Let me give you an example to explain this better. For example, annual return and balance sheet. This scheme gives you an opportunity to file, let's say, last year or 2 years backdated documents now. You will, if in any ordinary situations, you would have to shell out maybe lakhs of money to get this form filed with the ROC to be compliant. As against other times, now under the scheme, availing this benefit of the scheme, you will be not charged with any additional fee, but only immunity will be granted to you with respect to the penalty for filing these belated documents. So you are able to file old forms, but if you have contravened in conducting the annual general meeting, which is the basic requirement for an annual filing, if that has been contravened, there is no relaxation for that. You attract a lot of prosecution and penalties, and the adjudicating authorities can take action against you. In much more simpler terms, let me explain. It relates to waiver of additional fees and granting of immunity from launching prosecution or proceedings for imposing penalty on account of delay associated with certain filings. And the scheme's applicability, it is already applicable right from 1st April 2020. It has already started. And the government has given a long stretch period of 6 months. That is till 30th of September, the scheme's advantages are available to you. Now let's talk about objectives of the scheme. So we'll go to the slide where we go to objectives. Now, what is the objective of the scheme? The objective is to provide a fresh start for all defaulting and inactive companies. So as the scheme says, you are given another chance to come out compliant. The compliance's burden and the penalties have been reduced to great extent, where rather than paying double, triple the filing fees, all you pay is just a basic filing fee, the basic form filing fee, which ranges from 200 to maybe maximum 600 basis of your authorized capital. It's a one-time immunity against proceedings under the Companies Act, under Companies Act 2013, as well as 1956. And the biggest advantage of the scheme is that it is applicable irrespective of the period to which the default pertains to. So emphasizing on this point, even if you have non-complied with certain provisions or certain aspects of the Companies Act, let's say 5 years back, you have the window open today from 1st of April to 30th of September to come out compliant. Go ahead, file the form. You won't be penalized with any kind of penalty, but you do have to obtain an immunity. So that was about the objective of the scheme. Now, how is this scheme a relief to us, right? What makes it so good, such a happy celebrating moment for us with the CFS scheme? Well, a company which has been non-compliant for years, you have a chance to come out compliant. It's a waiver of additional fee for delayed filings by companies. Filing related to the defaults can be made good irrespective of the duration of default. So as I stated in the previous slide as well, that the duration of default is not a matter of concern over here. You can come out clean compliant on this. ROC shall withdraw all proceedings of adjudication of penalties under Section 454. You get an immunity from proceedings of imposing penalty. Now, this is something you have to read very carefully. I'll come to that point. Going ahead, inactive companies are given an opportunity to declare their companies as dormant companies. You can just file for dormancy if you're an inactive company, which you would not have been able to under any normal circumstance if the CFS scheme was not there. Now, when I mentioned about the immunity from prosecution and proceedings, what I mean is every non-compliance that you do, you attract penalty, you attract a lot of penal provisions also, not just a fine, not just a you have basically made an offense as well. A violation of law is an offense. So that is not forgivable in any act. But what is actually forgivable over here is lightening the penalty burden on you. Rather than paying thousands and lakhs of money for getting a form filed, you end up paying only a meager amount and you obtain immunity against that delayed filing, that penalty amount. However, it does not absolve you from the contravention of the law and any other consequential proceedings also. So let's say a certain form filing has led to a minority interest conflict. This immunity that you will get, you are not controlled or protected with that immunity certificate. That is a consequential proceeding which you will have to take a smart call whether you want to go for the filing or not, or come up with a different approach to that transaction or the compliance. So this is what the immunity is majorly talking about. Now, after having spoken what is the scheme about, what is the objective, what relief, the next question comes is, to whom is the scheme applicable? The applicability of the scheme. Now, the scheme shall be applicable for any defaulting companies and inactive company. I'll come to the details explaining what you mean by a defaulting company and an inactive company. But to understand the overall brief about it, what gain will the scheme give to an inactive defaulting company? It's anyways inactive, right? So what good can you make out of it? But when you're inactive, you are in the radar of various regulatory authorities. That means if you're inactive, you have not complied with multiple compliances, statutory compliances, maybe as per the Income Tax Act, maybe as per the GST Act or the Companies Act, all the regulatory authorities. So here in this case, the scheme, what benefit it brings to you is you are able to file for dormancy. So dormancy is another provision given by the Companies Act, which is ruled by Section 455. You will be able to file that without any additional fee at a normal fee, or you can also go for strike off. Now, going for strike off is very easy method, very easy way out. The scheme, there's a different interpretation of the scheme, and I would like to tell you my interpretation, and of course others' views are highly solicited on this. But what I strongly feel is, if you are inactive defaulting companies, rather than directly going for strike off, which is also an option available in the scheme, you should go be compliant, complete your ROC filings, adhere to the provisions of strike off, which is very well defined under Section 248, and then go for strike off. So that is my personal opinion, and that's how I would like to advise on such situations. But the scheme does give you an opportunity to directly go for strike off. And I would also revisit on this point that why I'm telling annual compliance is necessary. I'll bring you back to the conversation I started the presentation with, telling you may be allowed to file your annual returns form AOC 4 MGD7 without any penalty. But if you have not conducted your annual general meeting, that is a contravention of the section. There is no relaxation for that, and the immunity will not protect you from that. You open Pandora's box for all the regulatory authorities to pounce on you for non-compliance of some or the other section. So hence, it's a very wide scheme which is given, a 6-month timeline, which is enough for any company to come out clean and compliant. Going ahead about the applicability, now it is about the companies. Now, the scheme, it allows you to file various forms, but what are these forms without any additional fees? But there are certain exceptions to this form filing. Not every form has been given this ultimate relaxation to go ahead and file and avail the non-additional fee benefit. So annual filing forms, as I mentioned, AOC4, NGT7, these are the annual filing forms. Again, under AOC4, all the categories of AOC4 is covered, which includes your XBRL, your CFS, for NBFC companies, private limited companies, all the categories of AOC4 is covered. MGT7 lies the same for all. Event-based form. Now, this is a point where I really want to stress upon. INC 22A, active company tagging identities and verification. So if you all remember last year, this provision came. So going back a year in 2019, by the month of April, this form was launched with an intention that every company has to be tagged as active, wherein you have to point out which is your registered office, giving the latitude, longitude, address to that specific, as well as the presence of the key managerial person, along with an evidence of a photograph, him being inside the registered office. So this was a big move by the ministry to identify whether the companies are actually active or not. And the non-compliance of this resulted in a penalty of 10,000 rupees straight away. no compounding, no periodical government fee, but directly a fine of 10,000 rupees. I'm sure many companies have filed that and paid the fine as well to remain active, because a lot of consequential forms were restricted to be filed if you have not tagged yourself active. But through the scheme, this form is given a flexibility of being filed without any penalty. I think that's a huge relief for all the non-compliant companies. Going forward, INC 20A. So with INC 20A is what? It's a declaration of commencement of business. So when a company incorporates, and this has been made effective from 2nd November 2018 on or after, any company which is incorporating after that period, on that date, you have to file a declaration of commencement of business. And that has to be a proof of submission of the subscription money in the bank account of the company, and that your registered office is also in place. This has been given a timeline of 180 days. Now through the CFSS scheme and also through the amendments made, it has been given another extension of 180 days. So basically, if you incorporate a company today, let's say in April, you have a solid 360 days in your hand to open a company's bank account and deposit. But please remember that this is a compliance to be done. You cannot commence your business if you have not filed this form. So this is a technical wording of the Act, which talks about INC 20A. This is a big relaxation which gives you almost a year, but not a year. 360 days is a very long time. Then we have different forms. I have highlighted few of them. A few being past PAS3 form, which is filed for allotment of shares. You have an ADT1 form, appointment of director. MGT14. It's a very interesting form. MGT14 is required to be filed for resolutions and agreements, special resolution agreements that you're entering into. We also know that MGT14, if it is filed beyond 300 days, it attracts condemnation. Now, the question might come, does the scheme give you an immunity against that? Answer is no. When you have contravened, bringing you back to the main concept of this Act, when you have contravened a section, nothing in the Act will allow you to take advantage of immunity over here. You have to go ahead, compound for the, if it is being filed beyond 300 days, after filing for compounding, then you will be allowed to file this MGT 14, probably without any additional fee. But if it is beyond 300 days, your first step has to be compounding and thereafter filing of this form. Another form, DIF-12, which is a very critical form for all the companies for appointment and resignation of directors. And not just these forms, but many other forms. There are a total of 76 forms given by the ministry. And I have enlisted the website, the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, mca.gov.in, which has published a whole list of forms that can be filed taking advantage of the scheme. Now, what is the exception? There are two forms which cannot be filed through this. You cannot take advantage through the scheme. One is any form related to increase in authorized share capital of your company, which is form SH7, and any charge related documents, CAG1, CAG4, CAG8, CAG9. So these two, I really can't comment upon why these two have been specifically selected. I'm sure there's a lot of thought process behind it, but reality of the situation, we cannot take advantage of the scheme if you're trying to file SH7. Or charge-related forms. Now, having spoken about applicability, so the next question pops up, what is not applicable then? The universe is big, and something which is applicable, what gives us the non-applicability aspects as well? Well, if your company has already received a notice from the Registrar of Companies, a final notice of strike-off has already been given in the name of your company under Section 248 by the ROC, I'm sorry, you cannot take advantage of the scheme. If you are a company who has applied for strike-off voluntarily through this form STK2, and maybe it is in different stages, maybe it is pending for approval or it is in a resubmission state, any status, you cannot take advantage of this scheme. If you're a company who has amalgamated under a scheme of compromise and arrangement, you cannot do it. You might ask, what is the duration of it? Well, the notification is a bit silent about the duration, but it is deemed presumed that any kind of compromise or amalgamated company will not be able to take advantage of this act, of this notification. If you're a company who has applied for dormant status before the implementation of the scheme, so even before the scheme came, and you have applied for dormancy. So 30th of March is when the scheme got implemented. and you apply for dormancy, let's say on 29th March, by a missed by a whisker, I'm sorry, you cannot apply for it. Vanishing companies. So vanishing companies is a very interesting concept. It is not clearly defined in the Companies Act as well, but certain companies are deemed to be known as vanishing company if they have not done the requisite annual filings and or stock exchange disclosure for a continuous two-year period, and those who have not maintained the registered office and whose directors are untraceable. I'm sure many such companies are there in India, small companies or maybe big companies, but such vanishing companies cannot take advantage of the scheme. Of course, and as I stated before, wherever there is a compliance pending related to increase in authorized share capital and charge related documents, the scheme is not available for your advantage. Now, I've repeatedly spoken about few terms like defaulting company, inactive company, vanishing company. What are these actually and what defines them? So here I'm presenting a slide for you to understand, simplifying and decoding the Companies Act in the simplest form possible. So defaulting company means any kind of statutory default that you have made for filing any forms, be it the smallest or the biggest form, you are tagged as a defaulting company. And as the reading the section, quoting the section, basically a company, as per the Companies Act, which has made a default in filing any document, statement, returns, etc., including annual statutory document with the Ministry of Corporate Affairs Registry, is tagged as a defaulting company. What's an inactive company? Well, a lot of companies, I believe, will be falling in this bracket of inactive company. And let's see the definition to identify yourself. A, you have not carried any business or operation, or you could be a company who has not made any significant accounting transaction for the last 2 years, or you might not have filed financial statements or annual returns for the last 2 years. These are the three categories which helps you identify if you're an inactive company or not. Now, many might argue at this point that how do you define what you mean by a significant accounting transaction? Because any company, when they form and they operate, you're bound to have some of the other transactions ongoing, right? How do you differentiate between what is a significant transaction and what is not a significant transaction? Well, the Companies Act has been quite thoughtful about it, and they have given a lot of definition around it. They have defined what is a significant accounting transaction. So significant accounting transaction means payment of fees by any transaction or a payment of fees by a company to the registrar. So you're basically filing any ROC form, that's considered a significant accounting transaction. Payment made by the company to fulfill requirements of the act or any other law. Allotment of shares to fulfill. So allotment of shares could be a situation where you have got investment or you have issued share capital to someone else and you have filed the reporting form. Well, that accounts to a significant accounting transaction. Payment made for maintenance of office and records, that also accounts for significant accounting transaction. If you have had these transactions, then you will not be able to, you are not an inactive company per se. Now coming to vanishing companies, as I just described, it is deemed to be called a vanishing company if you have failed to file your ROC returns for 2 consecutive years, or let's say if you're a listed company and you have failed to file your returns with a stock exchange and you're continuing to be listed in that, to be listed for a period of 2 years, and you have not maintained a registered office and other notified places, what you have informed to the stock exchange, and your directors are not traceable. So many companies, to be called as a vanishing company, all these criteria have to be fulfilled, because the act defines each of these options as and, which is considered as a tag along option. So if only one fulfills and the others are not fulfilled, you won't be called as a vanishing company. So having said these definitions, which is very important for us to identify which category of company do we fall in order to understand whether the scheme is applicable to us or not, we'll next go to the process aspect of it. So going to the process, very simple, and to make it very crystal clear also to you, first step is please identify yourself. Which category do you fall in? Whether you are an inactive company or a defaulted company, are you a vanishing company? Are you eligible to take advantage of the scheme or not? So first step is self-identification. Second, please file the defaulted forms. Third, you have to file a declaration. That is the immunity certificate that we have been I have been speaking about and quoting in various conversations till now. You have to file a form to get this immunity certificate from the ROC. Submit that form and ROC will give you an acknowledgement of the same. And that's it. You're a compliant company. That's all it takes for you to be compliant. I've also tried to frame it a timeline and help you see things. See, when we talk about dates, I understand certain dates are a little difficult to understand and remember, right? But when we tabulate it in a manner which is easy for us to remember, even through a visual sight, it gets more easy to comply with. So the start of the scheme is 1st April. You get solid 6 months to comply. End of the scheme is 30th of September. During this scheme, you can file this period of relaxation. You can file numerous forms over there, what have been listed over here, and the 76 forms that I have quoted in my previous slide, which is available on the ministry's website. Second thing, once the scheme ends, only after that you can apply for immunity. I will talk about immunity even in more details in the upcoming slides, but just to understand over here, you can start applying for immunity only from 1st of October. Again, you have another 6 months time frame to apply for immunity and take advantage of it. So the last date to file immunity is again 31st March 2020. Now there are again certain situations where you cannot obtain immunity as well. Maybe I will be covering it in the upcoming slides. It would be quite a repetitive information, but there are certain cases where you cannot file for immunity. So if you, let's say your company is already having a court, a legal or an appeal pending in the court of law, you're having a management dispute before the court of law or the tribunal, or where the court has ordered conviction in any matter, your company or the director is convicted of certain non-compliances, and let's say an order imposing penalty has been already passed by the adjudicating authority. So if any of these situations persist in your company, you cannot apply for immunity, at least. Now that we have spoken so much about immunity, let's go and see what is the how do we do this immunity and application, and to understand what is this immunity certificate, why do we need it, how do we obtain it, and when is this effective. To understand in a very layman terms, let's take it like immunity is like a ticket, a safe ticket. A scheme is given to you. You have applied for the scheme, taken the benefit of it. But what is the record or the evidence that you have taken advantage of the scheme? You apply for immunity after the closure of the period given to you for availing this benefit. Unless and until you have this immunity certificate in your hand, and you have just taken advantage of the scheme but not notified the ROC that you have taken the benefits of the scheme, you are imposed to be prosecuted by the adjudicating authorities because you have not taken the immunity certificate. So your process ends by taking the certificate in your hand and not just completing the filing. So defaulting companies, you will be required to pay only nominal fee at the time of filing of belated documents and no additional fees charged. Upon filing, immunity will be granted to such companies that no prosecution or proceedings for imposing penalties will be initiated against such companies related to what? Related to such defaulted filings. But please note that the immunity will be granted only with respect to delay. So this is very critical to understand, and I think I'm repeating this point over and over again in this webinar, all through my slides, that this immunity is only with respect to the delay and not with respect to any consequential proceedings. Going further, who will issue this immunity? Well, the registrar of companies, where having its jurisdiction over the company, basically based on a registered office, the respective registrar of companies will be issuing the immunity certificate. Is it going to be an STP form? Is it going to be a approval-based form? That's still unknown, but it is understood that it will undergo a few scrutinies and then being given to you. And if you see the pro forma of the form that has been given in the circular, you have to quote every SRN that has been used for that company taking benefit of the CFSS scheme. Only after doing this, you get the immunity certificate. And this declaration, again stating, you have to do it within 6 months from the closure of the scheme. That is from 1st October to 31st March 2021, within this time frame, please apply for immunity. Who will issue? We have already discussed this. And after the closure of the scheme only, application will have to be filed for seeking immunity in respect of the belated documents. And you cannot file after the expiry of 6 months from the closure of the scheme. And you will be required to electronically file a CFSS form. And there is no fee available. There's no fee payable for filing the CFSS form. Insisting the point, in certain situations, you will not get immunity, which is if there's any appeal pending before the court of law, and it's a case of management dispute of the company pending before the court of law tribunal. If the court has ordered conviction in any other matter, or an order imposing penalty has already been passed by the adjudication authority, and you have not filed any appeal against such order before the scheme came into the force. So this is about the immunity certificate. Now, what is the effect of immunity? Okay, you have taken advantage of the scheme, you have filed the form, you have filed for immunity also, and you've got the certificate in hand. How are you benefited out of it? Re-insisting the point and re-emphasizing as well, the ROC will withdraw the proceedings or prosecutions, if any, from the court and the adjudicating authorities, which they usually take by quoting section 454, the adjudication of penalties, ROCs usually impose prosecution, but they will be withdrawing such prosecutions. But for cases where adjudication order has already been passed and appeal with respect to this has the appeal timeline, it falls between 1st of March to 31st of May. If that's a timeline, then you get another additional 120 days to reply to it. So breaking this and simplifying this for you, let's say in the month of January or February, you have got a prosecution order, or an adjudicating authority has passed an order for you to for some default, let's say. And you have been given that either you make the default good or you go ahead and file an appeal for it. You get 60 days. That's a standard timeline, which is given by the Act itself. But this scheme gives you, apart from the 60 days, and the 60 days basically falls between 1st of March to 31st of May. In between this timeline, if your appeal filing date falls in, you get another 120 days to file for an appeal. And that is the effect of this immunity for appeals in this case. And what is the consequence if the defaulting company is not using the scheme to comply? Well, after the scheme period, authorities have every right to penalize your company, initiate prosecution for the defaults not made good, even though this compliance window was given. So can't really guarantee, but I do foresee huge amount of non-compliances and penalties being imposed on the companies by ROC after the expiry of this scheme, if the companies do not take advantage of it. And if you continue to be remaining non-compliant, a Pandora's box opens with all kind of authorities charging upon you for non-compliances. Now, that's about the effect of immunity. Now, the important points to be spoken, I've already covered those things. Mostly, this is what the scheme is about. And I'm sure while reading the scheme, all of us have got numerous questions in mind about the applicability, or could be who can avail it. A lot of practical situations come up. So let's take questions which I have thought of, and we have addressed the same over here. Who can avail the scheme? As stated, any company who has failed to file any mandatory form, you are available to file this, take advantage of the scheme. Can officer in default avail the scheme as well? We would be asking, what is officer in default? Company by itself can't operate, right? It's going to authorize some person to give effect to certain resolution or give effect to certain work, execution of any assignment. So that person would be called an officer in default who is engaged with this, officially the authorized person to do this activity. This scheme cannot save the authorized, the officer in default. It only saves the company from, so the scheme is only for the defaulting company, not for your officer in default. And how will the defaulting company be benefited if they file the pending forms during the currency of this scheme? When you make the compliances good, there is no prosecution, no penalty imposed upon you till 30th of September. And provided that such prosecution, it is associated with filing related default. Again, if you contravene a section or the law, there is no immunity for you. You might be allowed to file the form, but you will not be protected under the scheme because you have violated the law. What is the time limit after which I can make pending compliances good? The start of the scheme has it's already begun 1st April 2020, and it will remain in force till 30th of September 2020. And therefore, the company shall remain. So this is a time frame, 6 months time frame. You have to do all the compliances good. Is the scheme eligible for inactive companies? Yes, the scheme is very well eligible for inactive companies. And this is extended to the defaulting companies, but at the same time, it also encourages you, the defaulting companies, to either you go for strike off or you declare yourself dormant. Can the benefit be availed by the director for updating KYC documents? Yes, even KYC form is also covered into this. If you have not filed, until last year, you would have been requiring to file form KYC 3, DR3 KYC, paying 5,000 rupees penalty. But now, under this scheme, there is no fees required to be paid. Till 30th of September, you can go ahead and file. Can the benefit be availed by directors for updating? Sorry, I've already covered this point. Next slide being, what about the companies where order is issued for belated filing return? So, well, in case where the penalties have been imposed on the act and the company has not further appealed to higher authorities, and such period of appeal, as I stated in the last conversation, that your appeals falls between 1st of March to 31st of May, a period of additional 120 days will be required, you will be given to file the appeal. Now, does the CFS's scheme waive off all kinds of prosecution or penalty? We have already discussed in the slides that it does not give you a clean sheet for every situation. If you have any matters pending with the court, no, you can't. If you have any management dispute in a company pending before the court, no, you can't. If an order of conviction has already been issued by the court and no appeal against such has been filed as on 1st April 2020, you can't. And where an order imposing penalty has been made and the adjudicating authority and no appeal has been preferred, well, you can't in this case as well. Going to the next question, a company is prosecuted for non-filing a form AOC for MGD7. Will it be immune from being prosecuted under the scheme? Well, if you file AOC for MGD7 before 30th of September and thereafter you file CFSS 2020 also, you will get immunity from being prosecuted pertaining to the delay, nothing else. Company was willing to apply for strike off its name due to the burden of penalties for non-filing. Is there any way that I can take benefit of the scheme? Well, yes, this is the time for you to take benefit of the scheme. You may file all the pending returns without any penalties under the CFSS, and you can continue. Either you can opt to continue your company or you can go for strike off. But as I said, recommendation is you please go ahead and file the returns. Can deactivated director be activated through the scheme? So deactivated director, it depends for what purpose have you been deactivated. Is it a disqualification under 164? If yes, sorry, you cannot be. But if you are deactivated because of non-filing of KYC, you have a chance of being active again if you go ahead and file KYC. In the scheme, the AOC4 form can be filed without filing previous year's form, as it's a repeated question, I believe, where yes, you are allowed to file this. The chronology really doesn't matter, but as a good corporate culture, yes, you should do in the chronological manner of filing. Whether CFS scheme is applicable for companies which have been automatically stuck off for non-filing, this is a scheme which is not being really in. If you're already stuck off, you really can't take advantage of the scheme. You have to first revive your company, go to NCLT, and then take an order, and then you can come out compliant. For filing commencement of business form to the newly incorporated companies, now additional 180 days is allowed, but which companies are allowed? such benefit? What is the cutoff date for newly incorporated companies to companies incorporated from which date does this benefit pass on? So as I stated, for all these newly incorporated companies, your INC 20 deadline has got additional 180 days, gives you 360 days to comply. That's a well sufficient timeline to go ahead and file the forms. And yes, this has been the circular. You can refer to the circular March 2020, where this is allowed. Next question being whether immunity certificate will be generated automatically once the CFS is formed. Again, completely based on the ROC, jurisdictional ROC will subject to the examination issue the certificate. Will MCA be refunding additional fees as the clients have paid the same during the filing season? To be honest, what has been paid is paid. There's no way to claim it back. Well, I would say that's bad luck. But now if you fail, you would not be charged with any kind of fee. If the director has been disqualified in 16-17, filing is pending, can the still benefit be extended? See, if both your directors are disqualified under 164 and there's no authorized signatories left in the company, you will have to approach a jurisdictional ROC, have a back-end entry done for your director, get him on record, and then go ahead and complete the filing. Well, I'm sure these are all the general questions which come up while and as and when we look into this and the scheme. So I think I was able to address to most of these questions.
So apart from the questions that you've taken us through, there are a few additional questions from our users. So I'll just ask them one by one. In case you've covered these questions, you just need to mention that you've done so and we'll move ahead.
Sure.
Okay. So Advocate Balachandran Krishnan, he's from the company Intellectual Innovation Patent Consultancy Services Private Limited from Kerala. So he's asked the question that he wants to wind up a few companies. So he wants to know whether we can wind up without compliance of ROC.
Great. Mr. Balachandran, I think I did address this point in my presentation, stating that wind up and strike off are two little different concepts having totally different procedures involved in that. But if you're intending to mean it as a strike off, the scheme does allow you to go for a strike off. But as a good corporate compliance and not to and to avoid any kind of future prosecution being imposed upon you and the company, it is advisable that you please complete your annual filing and then go for closure. Because if you read the respective sections, 248 especially, it talks about completing your filings and then go for closure. And of course, you have to go through your records, your transactions and your transactions all around the year to analyze whether these are significant transactions or there is revenue earned. So a lot of aspects have to be considered in that. But again, to answer to your question, Mr. Balachandran, you should go for a full compliance and then go for strike off. Yes.
All right. Okay. So moving on, we have Mr. Lokrapam Hirojit from Lesemba Furnace Solutions from the city of Imphal. So he's asked the question, how to waive penalties for delayed filings?
Great question, Mr. Lokrapam. I think this is a question which is revolving in everyone's mind, how to avoid these delayed filings or waive these filings. There's two way out. One is please be compliant. Second thing is, if you're non-compliant, you should really pray to your stars that another scheme like this gets launched by Ministry of Corporate Affairs and you get a chance to pay all the penalties. Don't pay for the penalty and go for the filing. But the best way out is please be compliant on the timelines. Companies Act gives sufficient time to all the stakeholders over here to comply with your compliances. Any event happens, you have a solid 30 days time to go ahead and complete the compliance. Now, 30 days is sufficient time to be compliant, sir. So my recommendation is there's technically no way out unless and until another scheme comes into picture and gives you another scheme like CFSS.
Okay, moving on. Mr. Eugene Rebello from Fortivative Studios in Mumbai. Please state early on if any benefits for folks who haven't been penalized.
Mr. Rebello, I think it's a green signal that yes, you are all compliant and there's not no relaxation per se, but of course a pat on your back that you're a healthy compliant company.
Okay, moving on. Mr. Sahil Singh from Ogadio Solutions in Mehsana. Documents and process for registration of a private limited company. I don't think that's related to what we're discussing here.
I think he's asked about Mr. Sahil, I would say please do connect with us. We'll be able to help you incorporate your company and it would be a very simple process through. Yes, at Vakilsearch, we do incorporate companies and you will have a hassle-free process for that.
Okay, so moving on. Mr. Aditya Jain from Shapeman Technologies Private Limited. I'm unable to deposit paid up capital for company and produce bank statement to file INC 20A form due to bank closure. What should I do?
Bank closure is a fact of the situation where until and unless a lockdown is uplifted, no one can approach the bank to open your bank account. However, the compliance of INC 20A remains at its place, but the scheme gives you additional 120 days. So if I heard the question right, you incorporated on April 2nd or sometime soon? Or if you're a newly
He said he is unable to deposit paid up capital for company and produce bank statement to file INC 20A form.
Got it. Mr. Aditya, I would tell you that submitting bank statement is of course a conclusive proof of bringing the subscribed capital and that is required for filing INC 20A. But in such a situation, either you wait for another additional 180 days because you have a wider bracket, or there are other means also to record the submission of this money. So it can be by way of maybe a cash deposit. But again, we should consider the income tax provisions also that, you know, to a certain amount, only cash deposit can be made in the company, not beyond that. You can have a DD. My advice would be best if you could wait for another 180 days because that's already there in the timeline and you can go ahead and file. Otherwise, a cash deposit serves good, provided, or a demand draft also serves good. But considering that the banks are also closed and that extension of 180 days is there, you have a wide time frame to comply for this.
All right. So moving on, Mr. Yuvraj Palanasamy from Thanasi Infotech Private Limited, Chennai. How to avoid penalty with respect to annual compliance?
There's a very simple way out, Mr. Yuvraj, how to avoid penalties. Please be compliant on the timelines. Often many clients actually say that your compliances are becoming too expensive. Well, I would say please try non-compliance. You will find compliance is very cheap in that case. It's a hardly 300, 400 rupee form that you're filing at the right timelines of hardly 30 days from the happening of the event. So the best way to be not having any penalty attracted is to be compliant and within the timelines do the filing.
Okay, so the next question is something similar. It's not related to penalty. I'll repeat. Mr. Deepak Kumar from Ardeep Buildcons and Infratech Private Limited in Patna. So he says that he has not filed any compliance with respect to his company from the date of incorporation to present. So he wants to start his company fresh. So can he proceed? I think that's what he's asking.
Yes, Mr. Deepak, and I think this is a great time for you as well to start, and you perfectly fall into the definition of an inactive or a defaulted company because you have not filed and you're non-compliant for such a long time. And the steps would be, please identify what forms have you not filed. Please contact a professional. Do come to us. We'll be able to help you out, come out compliant. You can take a call if you want to continue the company. Great. File all the annual return forms at once. Obtain the immunity certificate and you're good to go. If you want to close the company, you can still go ahead, file your annual returns and then go for closure. So, yeah.
Okay. Moving on, Mr. Aniruddha Roy Chowdhury from Hello Star Media in Kolkata. So his company was incorporated on April 2, 2020. That is during the COVID pandemic, during this lockdown process. So he says that since the banks were not working, account has still not been opened, I guess. So there is a technicality over there.
That's preventing him
from.
Right. And I think that's a very practical situation many companies are facing as well. banks not being operators, you're not able to open bank account. But having also witnessed certain banks which do provide you more hassle-free way of opening account, that is one option where online you can open an Insta account. Or again, repeating the provision that has been given in the Act, you get additional 180 days, a total of 360 days for you to file INC 20A and to be compliant. So let's wait for the lockdown to be uplifted. You can go to the bank, open your bank account, and that you will be still within the time frame. But please do not forget to file CFSS form for immunity after 30th of September. That has to be properly noted. Yes, Renoy, next question.
All right, moving ahead, Mr. Rupinder Singh from Exampton EduTech Solutions Private Limited in Chandigarh. He's asked a simple question relating to compliance. I think it's regarding the process involved.
Yes, if you see compliance, Mr. Upendra, it's a very wide term. And when you talk about secretarial compliances, it depends what kind of company you are, what type of, it's a private limited company, it's a small company, or it's not a small company, from which year you have incorporated. So all over the quarters, there are a lot of compliances in a year. You start with quarter one, you have to take disclosure of interest. You have to file certain forms like INC 20A if you're a newly incorporated company not within the first quarter, but within the first 180 days of your incorporation. Thereafter, you have annual filing if you're already an existing company, which comes in September. Thereafter, if you have taken any loans, anything is outstanding, you have to file the DPD3 forms within the timeline. If you have any significant beneficial owner in your company, you have to file for the BEN form. Thereafter, you come, if you have any investments come flown in the company, you have an RBI compliance which is attached. So all across the year, if I say every 12 month of a calendar is having one or the other compliance which is applicable for a company. So obviously in this webinar, it's difficult for me to brief it through all together, but yes, please contact a professional to keep your company compliant.
Okay, so moving on, we have Mr. Prasad Paradkar from G5A Foundation for Contemporary Culture in Mumbai. So his question is regarding that compliance for non-profit organizations registered under Section 8 of New Companies Act 2013.
Coming back, so the Section 8 company compliances are not any different from any other private limited company compliances. Depends if your Section 8 compliance is it is limited by shares or with guarantee. If it is limited with shares, you also fall into the purview of complying INC 20A formality. If it is not, I mean, it is limited by guarantee, you don't have to file that. But you do have to conduct your board meetings in every quarters. You do have to conduct annual general meeting and file the AOC 4 form, MGT 7 form. So the statutory compliances are same. There's not much relaxation to you on that.
All right. So this would be the last question. This is Mr. Abdul Razak from Kerala. He's from the his company is Crop and Rich Agriculture Private Limited. So he's asked the question that we have received an adjudication order from ROC Ernakulam, that's in Cochin, not filed an appeal. What is the next procedure to get benefit?
So if you recall in my last Mr. Abdul, in my last slide, I spoke about appeals and immunity certificate. So if you have already received an order and you, as you state, you have not taken an appeal yet, you have another timeline of 120 days. If your appeal duration of 60 days fell between 1st of March to 31st of May, you have another 120 days to file for an appeal. This is the relaxation that you get from the scheme. An extended timeline to file the appeal.
Okay. So there is one more question coming in. It's Mr. Ranganathan Deshpande from Sri Chandrala Global Private Limited in Bangalore. What are the technical issues or requirements as per compliance involved with getting investments or securing investments, I guess?
Okay. Mr. Ranganathan, this is a very wide question. So when you talk about investments, I think it will be another seminar by itself altogether. There are different categories of what kind of investment you want, what kind of securities you want to issue, to whom are you giving. You have to identify a lot of, so when I say technicalities, yes, a lot of technicalities are involved in that. You have to identify whether an RBI compliance is involved or not, whether you have sufficient authorized capital or not. What are your existing shareholders' agreement, if you have any agreements, investor agreements? What are their clauses about new investments coming in? So these things have to be analyzed. So we usually what we do is we will do a secretarial audit, a legal audit, or a due diligence is being done to check both the parties and the credit rating of the other party or the investor also that you're bringing, and your company's valuation aspects as well. So a lot of technicalities are involved, sir. And I think I would love to address this question one-on-one with you. But on this platform, I think it would be quite irrelevant to a larger crowd. But please do drop in your query, and we will definitely get back to you arranging a one-on-one call for this.
Okay, so with that, we've come to the end of the webinar and end of the questions. I'm just checking if there are any more questions left to be asked. Yes, we've handled all the questions so far. So Ahona, a big thank you to you. I mean, for the last 1 hour, you've taken us through all these details and gone in depth. You know, I think every person who's tuned in, it's been helpful for them. So thank you for all the information and for your time. This is, how are things over there in Chennai?
Chennai is in a lockdown phase right now. So as I said, we all indoors only and waiting for the lockdown to be uplifted. But each day cases are increasing. Okay. So fingers crossed, I hope by end of this month, we see some good news coming in.
Yes, definitely. Yes. So we've all been working from home, and I think it's important to remain hopeful during this time of day. And, you know, I think we can all come out stronger after going through this entire trial of, sitting at home and going through all this difficulties. So when we come out, we will be stronger. That's what I believe. So with that, I think, yes. So with that, we come to the end of our session. I am sure all our users have found this helpful. Thank you for joining us today. Until next time, stay home, be safe, and take care. Follow us on our social media pages on Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn for our regular updates. On behalf of Vakilsearch, this is Rinoy George and Ahona. So Ahona, would you like to wish everyone a good evening? And
yes, a very good evening, and thank you for being patient listeners to a very dry topic. Try to make it as simple as possible. And I hope all of you stay safe. Please stay at home, and let's pray for an early, healthy life to begin again.
Well said, Ahona. Thank you all. Have a good evening and have a great weekend ahead. Take it.
Yeah. Great. Thank you.
Get 300 plus services. Chat and email with our team directly. Get stunning discounts and rewards. Only on Vakilsearch app. Download now.